Hey there, everybody. Welcome to the first episode of my series on property-based testing techniques demonstrated on real SerenityOS code, fixing real bugs. Today's property-based testing lesson is going to be about generalizing unit tests, meaning sometimes we get lazy and only test the happy path in our unit tests, but how can we be sure it will not blow up if we choose a slightly different value, right, for one of the inputs? Are we overlooking some edge cases? Property-based testing will allow us to try many different values and gain larger confidence that our program works over these values, not only over the few cases that we hard-coded. I have used this generalizing technique recently to find a bug in SerenityOS's bitmap class, so let's have a look. Bitmap is quite simply a collection of booleans where you can check if a boolean on a given index is true or false. So let me try to sketch this out. So you have an array of, let's say, I'm gonna write zeros and ones, but you know, these are effectively booleans. So something like that, right? And you can do get on the first index. So this is, you know, 0, 1, 2, 3. So this will give you false, right? If I get on the seventh index, 4, 5, 6, 7, right, that's gonna be true. I can set on a given index, so set 3 true, so that's gonna make this into a 1, and so on, right? And so there are these other methods that are helpful, let's say, for, you know, manual memory management, methods that let you test or find like a continuous chunk of zeroed memory, right? And so there are things like find first unset, and here this would probably, you know, give you zero, like the index where the first zero is. Find first set, that would be 1, right? Find first fit, so this would search for like a chunk where there are 4 zeros. So if we did this before the set, it would find this chunk of 4 zeros, right? So it would give me the index 3, and so on. You know, there is like set range, right, so on index 5 with length 2, set everything to true. So this would be 4, 5. So we would set these to 1s, right? And stuff like that. So basically, it's an array of booleans or of bits. And in SerenityOS, this lives in the files, aka bitmap and bitmap view, right? And so bitmap is a specific implementation, and bitmap view is kind of like an interface which you can, you know, different classes can implement this interface. You know, we have this like set range, and we have find first set, for example, right? So that's where the code lives. And so there are already some tests. So test bitmap, and that's great because we want to take some of these tests that only use, you know, hard-coded examples, and we want to generalize them. So For example, you know, these tests look pretty good. And so in the previous introduction video, I commented on how with unit tests, you don't really have a huge guarantee that you didn't just like miss an interesting case, right? And that's going to be exactly what happens here. So having written these tests and fixed the code already, I know where to look, but let's look at this file with fresh eyes, you know, as if I didn't know. And so remember the goal. The goal is to see if some unit tests could be generalized to randomly pick values from a range instead of using hard-coded numbers. And so if I go from the top of the file, the first test case, you know, constructs an empty bitmap, but there's no like input value, right? There's no saying how large it is or like what values it should have. So we can't really generalize this in any way. So let's skip over this test. But again, the very next two tests are interesting because they, you know, they test some interesting behavior for the find first set and find first unset functions or methods. And they have, you know, magic numbers. And that's one of the, you know, red flags. Like we can generalize that. So we can change, you know, the 128, we can change the 69 into something random. And the true and false here, we can, you know, randomize over those as well. So let's have a look. 128 is gonna be the size. So we are creating a bitmap of size 128 bits. The 69 is gonna be the index at which we are setting something. The false at the top, that's gonna be like the default value with which we are, you know, creating the bitmap. So if we put true there, everything would be true from the beginning. So false at the top is gonna be the like init or default value, and the true in the set line, that's gonna be like the new value that we want to set. And you can imagine using, you know, random values for each of these four items. So random size, random index at which we will, you know, set random booleans. So let's copy the test over and convert it into a randomized one. So let me put it here. And now, so this is going to be randomized, find first, generalized. I need to add a namespace for the generators. So that's that. And now we need to do the generation. So gen size is gonna be an unsigned int, index as well, init is gonna be a boolean, and the value is gonna be boolean as well. So that's the generation. These gen lines basically just mean, you know, like auto size equals gen unsigned int, but they automatically at printing when it finds a failure, it will tell us, you know, so size was this, index was this, and so on. So that's just like, I guess the encouraged practice for how to write the randomized tests in here. Now the question is, what kind of numbers do I want to generate? So for the bitmap size, I think it would be good to go at least as big as 128. And for the lower limit, I think for this test, it doesn't make sense to start with zero. So we don't want to be able to create empty bitmaps because we are gonna set something in it, right? And so we need it to be like, we need it to have at least one item. So let's do at least size one bit. And index, so now that we have generated the size, you know, again, remember this is kind of like auto size equals something, and like this is, you know, an integer. So we can use the size here. So index can start with zero, and the the higher limit on that is going to be size minus one. And booleans, they are fine, right? There's only two values. Okay, and so now we need to switch, you know, these hard-coded values and actually use the new variables. So size init, and at index we are gonna set the value. And so now we need to actually change what the test does, because both of these booleans are completely random. We can have a situation where we are setting a bit true that was already true, right? And, or, you know, setting a bit false that was already false. And so we can't really say, you know, the first bit in there is gonna be on the index. No, it could be on the index zero as well. So we are gonna do something a little bit different. We are not gonna check that the value is a specific integer, but we are gonna check that it has a value. So let me do that quickly. So so based on whether we are setting a true boolean or a false boolean, let's try different operations. So find first set or find first unset. And now the expectation is gonna be result has value, right? So this should always give us something, because if we have been setting a true value, there's definitely going to be a set value somewhere if the program works. So I think that should be it. Now we can try to run it. So let me close that and test bitmap. Right. Okay. And we can see the test failed. Right, and so we can see these values that are printed because we used the gen macro, and it tells us, you know, this specific expectation failed, which is exactly this one. And you can see it gave us fairly minimal example. Like, I think that's all of the like lower limits. It couldn't have like tried to minimize it any further. So this is a combination of inputs that causes the expectation to fail. If you want to see what it tried before that, we can sprinkle in some, you know, print calls, to see all the values that are being tried. So warn, oops. So let's show the four values, size, index, init, and value. Now let's try it again. And we can see, you know, it tried a few things, right? And then it kind of stumbled upon this example. We can also see the exact point at which it, you know, found a failure and started shrinking. So we can do something like if result has value, warn okay. Let's try that. and you can see, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it tried 5 examples and then it found the 7 where it started failing, and then it tried to shrink. So it shrunk, you know, the size, and then it shrunk the booleans, right? And it arrived at what we saw before. I could try to run again, and now there's, you know, many more. So it tried, all that stuff worked pretty well, and then it found, oh no, 2-0, true, false, this fails. And again, it shrunk it down. So that's how it works. And so you can imagine, as the bugs get harder and harder to trigger, the test runner will have to try more and more combinations. And usually in property-based testing, it will stop at like 100 examples, but you can, you know, tweak the number, or, you know, in your CI, you know, when you fuzz programs, that usually runs, you know, 24/7, it runs nonstop. So yeah, there's different strategies for that. So, okay, let's remove the printing and let's move these values over. We can make a test case from those. So a value was false, so it's an unset test. So let's copy this thing. And so now size was 1, init was false. And at index 0, we set false. And find first unset has value, right? So that's basically what the test was about, what the test was doing. If we, you know, if you kind of like copied this over, pasted these values over, this is what was running. So let me run that. And now we can see we have 2 failing tests, right? We have the randomized one, as always, but we also have failure in the unset test. And it's on the line 40, so that's this one. So now we have a reproducible test case. And now we can find what the issue is. So bitmap view. Find first unset, it just delegates to find first, right? So there's this function. And I will fast forward this part a bit. The bug lies in an off by one error when converting the size in bits to size in bytes. So if you have a bitmap of size that's not divisible by 8, we mistakenly ignored that remainder, right? The last partial byte when searching. And so I am telling you this, you know, because I spent some time on it, but imagine yourself, you know, forming that kind of hypothesis while reading this code, you know, like what could go wrong? This is like pretty simple loop, what's going on? So you kind of like think, okay, maybe this is something weird about like this last byte. Right? And so property-based testing can help you here as well. So let's go back to our test. And we can tweak our test to like, you know, skip those inputs. So I could do this a few different ways. I could do something like assume size divided by 8 is 0, so it will always only give me integers that are aligned. Or I could do, you know, size in bytes and then size equals size bytes, size in bytes times 8, and so all the, you know, all the code below will use this aligned value. And it's, in property-based testing, it's always, or usually it's better to construct your values instead of filtering them. So I'm gonna, you know, keep this one. And so let's run this again. And now we only have failure in the unset test, right? So this is the non-aligned one, but our generalized test is passing, right? I could run it multiple times and it will pass. So this is a pretty good, like, it's not a proof, but it's good evidence that this has something to do with these like unaligned inputs. So let me put this back. Let's run this again. Right, and now again, we have our randomized failure. So this is pretty great for checking your assumptions. So now let me quickly fix the bug. And again, I've done this before, so this is pre-rehearsed. Basically here we are using the floor division and we should be using the ceiling division, which is what size in bytes does, right? There's ceiling division and I think size in bytes reads better than me trying to like do, you know, casting and stuff. So size in bytes, boom, done. And that's, you know, that's how easy the fix was, but obviously there were, there was more thoughts, you know, going into it the first time. And now the test passes. So let me bring the printing again into the test and we can see what it tries. So warn size index init value, and when we have, you know, when all the tests pass, we are not showing the standard out. So let me run this in a slightly different way. Test bitmap. Okay, right, and so now we can see it really tries a lot of stuff. And it's, again, it's like 100 times, 100 values it tries before saying, okay, you know, this time you got away with it. It passes the test, but, you know, maybe next time it will get lucky and find some edge case that triggers, you know, some other bug. So again, as Dijkstra said, you know, tests are not a proof of absence of bugs, but at least now we have much higher confidence that the function does what we want over this set of inputs, right? And so again, maybe there's a bug where this number is like 1024 or something like that. We don't know. We are testing over this set of numbers, and here it passes. And so I want to kind of like reflect on what just happened. We didn't have to think of the leftover byte edge case. The randomized test found it for us, right? It's the computer is much better at finding these things that than humans are. So in my opinion, this is great improvement over unit tests that, you know, just try a few cases, because in unit tests, you have to be the one who finds these cases, right? Who thinks of these numbers and tries them. And maybe you are lucky and maybe you tried an unaligned number, but maybe you're not, right? Maybe you just had some nice example that worked, you know, 128, pretty nice. So, you know, let the computer generate those edge cases for you and try them. You also saw that I had to tweak the expectation a little bit because, you know, there were no specific inputs anymore. and so I couldn't have any specific like output in there. You know, maybe if I didn't generalize over the booleans, I would be able to set up the test in such a way that I would be able to say, okay, the index is definitely going to be, you know, the randomized index. So the more general you go, usually the more general the property will have to be that you are testing, right? But suddenly, you know, the generality is a good thing. Suddenly you're testing much larger portion of the input space. And yeah, that's it. That was the first property-based testing lesson. So generalize your inputs. And I hope you liked it. And so, yeah, see you in the next one. Bye.